Today we've got Dr. Vanessa May coming to talk to us about the temporal aspects of belonging and the self. Vanessa May is from the University of Manchester. She's researched and published in the area of lone parenting and motherhood and intergenerational relationships and personal life. She also wrote an excellent book in 2013 entitled Connecting the Self to Society. And in her most recent work, which I think she's going to be talking about today, she's drawn on data from the Mass Observation Archive to talk about belonging and also the self and identity. So,
Thank you. So first of all, thank you, Tracy, for inviting me here. It's really nice to be in Huddersfield. The first time I came to Huddersfield was, I think, in 2005 or 2004, and that was for a conference, and we were in these rooms. So it feels like coming home when I come here today. So as Tracy said, today I'm going to talk about how people experience their sense of belonging as a temporal experience, and I'll be looking at the significance of why it's important to look at belonging as a temporal experience through the lens of the self. And in my work, I've defined belonging as a sense of ease both with oneself and with one's surroundings, so that's including people, places, and cultures. So belonging is a multidimensional experience, and that's why it's very interesting to do research on it, because you're touching on every aspect of people's everyday lives, basically. And why it's important to look at belonging when we're looking at the self is because I argue that belonging is of a fundamental importance in terms of how we construct a sense of self. So if we understand the self, as Jerome Bruner does, as the distributed self, that is a self that's not an atomistic individual, not seen as separate from other people, but rather a distributed self that's enmeshed in networks with others. So as George Herbert Mead would say, a self that's created in relationships with other people, a self who gains a sense of who they are in relation to social norms, for example, so the surrounding world. But particularly relationships with people here are central. So this means then that one of the ways in which we experience the world is through a sense of belonging, so that sense of connectedness with that world that gives us our sense of self. In the research on belonging, belonging is mostly treated as something that's anchored in particular geographical places. So there's a lot of research on people's sense of belonging to place. And particularly a lot of the research is in relation to how, for example, transnational migrants experience geographical mobility. So what geographical mobility does to people's sense of belonging. So although belonging is understood as a dynamic experience that changes and shifts over time, the very aspect of time, so belonging is tethered to time, is something that hasn't received very much attention so far. So as Tracy mentioned, I'm using Mass Observation Project data here. I'm assuming that not everyone knows what the Mass Observation Project is or what it does. Mass observation, in its current form, started in 1981 as a writing project. And the writing project works so that there's a panel of volunteer writers, usually about 500 at any one time. Some people have been writing since 1981, so there are some people who've kind of been there from the start. But as people sort of drop off, as they lose interest or as they also die, new volunteer writers are then added to the panel. So there are 500 volunteer writers part of the panel. Three times a year, Mass Observation sends them a directive, it's called a directive, asking them to write about specific topics. And the topics have ranged from royal weddings to funerals, to shopping, family pets, family holidays, and so on. So in 2010, I commissioned a directive on belonging. And it works so that you, if you want to commission a directive on with Mass Observation, they work together with you to write the directive. So there's about up to an A4 size of paper that gives instructions to mass observers, so the panel of volunteer writers who are called mass observers. They are given sort of a guidance on what's expected, so what kind of things they're expected to cover. And then, of course, it's up to them what they write in their responses. So I had a directive on belonging in 2010, and this was partly because I'm interested in trying to get at how people experience belonging and how they understand it in their own lives. And in some previous work, doing interviews with people, we found that actually talking to people about belonging can be quite difficult. It's a lot easier to talk about not belonging, but when you actually ask people, what does belonging mean to you and how do you experience belonging, this might be something that people need a bit more time to reflect on and come back to it and so on. So mass observation is perfect for that because it allows people that time, first of all, to decide, is this something I want to write about, but then also allows them time to think about it and craft their answer. So in terms of getting accounts on what belonging is and how it's experienced, the mass observation data has proved very fruitful for that. So in the directive, I've got a little quote from the directive as a kind of showing you that actually, although I wasn't interested in time and temporality at the time, I was actually priming the mass observers to think about time and change over time. So I was asking them about how their sense of belonging had changed over time and what might have caused these shifts. And we also asked them to specifically consider their changes in their sense of, I call it relational belonging, so sense of belonging to people, and also their sense of belonging to place. So I asked them to draw these relationship diagrams and then to also list places where they felt a sense of belonging to now and 10 years ago, and to compare those changes, if any changes had taken place. So this directive on belonging, we got 180 responses, which is about the norm for these mass observation directives. And for the paper that I'm presenting today, I've chosen a subsample of those 180. So the subsample were chosen on the basis that these were accounts where the mass observers explicitly talked about time. So they talked about, for example, they explicitly compared past and present in relation to kind of the passage of time, for example. And the sample characteristics for these 62 are fairly similar to the overall characteristics of the volunteer panel of volunteer writers for mass observation in overall, in that the majority were women. The average age is fairly high, so average age is 55, and that's true for mass observation in general as well. But there's a range, so the youngest writer is 20 and the oldest is 91. Majority are either working in white-collar occupations or have retired from white-collar occupations, and I assume them to be white British because none of them mention their ethnicity. And of course that's something that you can do if you're part of a majority ethnic group. You have the luxury of not noticing your ethnicity and therefore not writing about it. And also majority heterosexual. Again, that's an assumption because only two of the writers mention that they're gay men. And for the paper today, I'm going to focus on particularly how these mass observers, how they accounted for the duration of their sense of belonging or their senses of belonging. So I'll start with accounts of where the duration of belonging is talked about in a linear fashion. And these are to do with relationships to people, so sense of belonging to people. And on what there's a continuum in terms of the duration of sense of belonging to people. There's a continuum from enduring belonging to then fleeting belonging, and I'll cover this continuum now. So on the one end of the scale we have enduring relational belonging, so relationships that are expected to endure and that do endure, so they stand the test of time. And in these accounts, family relationships, unsurprisingly, family relationships are presented as the gold standard for enduring relational belonging. And this is, of course, because in our culture, family is taken to be, you know, as Spencer and Powell have said, family is given, friends are chosen. So in these accounts, the fact that their family relationships endure is a taken for granted thing. So they don't explain. So we have statements such as, once a member of a family, you belong forever. So these are almost statements of fact. This is just how the world is. That once, that your family of origin is a source of enduring relational belonging. That doesn't mean that for all of these people, that relationship with their family of origin doesn't have ambiguity. So there might be a lot of ambiguity there. But there were only a few people who talked about actually cutting ties with their families of origin. So there is a sense that you really can't choose your family, and once you're born into a family, that's your family for life, whether or not you're happy with that fact. And there's also the sense that even if we don't see family members often, so again, this is something that we probably recognise, many of us, from our own lives, there's a sense that even if you don't see family members often, you know, that there's still that sense of belonging to that group. And in contrast then, those family relationships that don't endure, those family relationships that sort of either are cut off altogether or where the quality of the relationship is described as very bad, those are the ones that require explanation. So those are not taken for granted. And here's an example of how that might be explained. So in this case, the mass observer is saying that about her brother, that in a time of crisis when the mass observer herself was very ill, she noticed that her brother had a complete inability to cope and be supportive, and as a result their relationship has deteriorated significantly. Then when it comes to friendships, again, as Spencer and Pyle say, friends are considered as chosen in our culture. So this notion that if a friendship endures, it tells us something different from if a family relationship endures. So a friendship that endures actually might say something about the self, as I'll go on to say in a few minutes. So there's an assumption in these accounts that friendships will come and go, as that one mass observer says. So the assumption is that friendships do undergo change. And unlike with the family, enduring family relationships, it's actually the enduring friendships that require explanation. And the mass observers do spend quite a lot of time explaining why certain friendships have endured, sometimes across many, many decades. And I've picked two quotes here of the kind of things that mass observers are telling us about this. So one is about the emotional connection to friends. So the first mass observer says that his enduring friendships are with people who like him and who think of him. So that sense of that kind of emotional connectedness, but also a sense of intimacy and perhaps a sense of sort of caring for each other. And the second mass observer says that she has remained friends with people who display consistency and common values. And this is something I'll come back to in a minute, that idea that enduring friendships are ones where people actually display a sense of authentic self. But I'll come back to that in a minute. So there's a sense that in explaining why some of their friendships have endured over time, the mass observers explain it by saying that these are all-encompassing relationships. So these are relationships that are based on an all-encompassing intimate knowledge of each other. And of course, this is backed up by a lot of the research on friendship that talks about, for example, the importance of mutual trust and reciprocity in terms of intimacy and sharing emotions and support and so on. So there's a sense that in these enduring friendships, the person is known in the round, both the person, the mass observer writing, but also they feel that they know their friends on this intimate level. And then we started out with enduring family relationships, and then at the other end of the scale are friendships that don't stand the test of time. So there's kind of more fleeting friendships that come and go. And most commonly, the mass observers will name relationships with work colleagues as this kind of friendship that doesn't actually last. And the reason for this is that these are friendships that are seen to be based not on that sense of knowing the person in the round, but rather on knowing a particular aspect of that person and also sharing a particular aspect of your life, so sharing your working life together. And many of the mass observers say that you might feel a very close connection with work colleagues, but in the most part, this kind of intimacy, sense of intimacy, then kind of disappears if you change jobs or if your friend changes jobs. So like the mass observer there says that these kind of relationships she has found are based on a false intimacy that soon dissipates once you've left a job. And that's because there's nothing left in common. So once you don't have that shared job in common, the shared intimacy is gone as well. And as the other mass observer there says, that the source of connection is work and not real friendship. And the word real here is quite interesting. Because what mass observers are doing when they depict their relationships on this scale from fleeting through to enduring, what they're doing is they are also making normative judgments, and they're also telling us something about themselves. So by depicting enduring relationships as authentic, as real, and fleeting relationships as superficial, I argue that mass observers, they're doing something with those accounts in terms of depicting particular aspects of themselves. What the mass observers don't tell us is, why is this distinction so important? I think a lot of what I've said up till now probably resonates with a lot of you in the room. You know this, that if you know, because in our culture, family and friendships are viewed in this way, you probably all think that, yeah, that's pretty much how I might view things as well. So why is this distinction so important? And I'm going to argue that it's important for two reasons. It's important in terms of how we present ourselves, in terms of social norms of how we expect it to present itself, but that it's also important in terms of what autobiographical narrating, the role of autobiographical narrating, the function of telling autobiographical stories. And I'll go through each of them now. So in terms of this distinction being important because of what's expected of us as Western selves in terms of how we present ourselves, we can look at work by Danny Miller, who has compared Western constructions of self with Trinidadian constructions of self. Now, Miller argues that in the West, the assumption is that we have a true self that's hidden deep inside. And that's our authentic self. It's our inherent self that we're born with, and it's a self that doesn't change over time. So it can't be altered over time. And that's what makes it true, that's what makes it authentic. Nothing can change it. So everything else for Western notions of the self is that the truth lies deep inside, whereas lies can be presented on the surface. Miller then says that in Trinidad, the understanding of what the self is the polar opposite to that. So Miller says that in Trinidad, the view is that lies can be buried, lies can be hidden inside, whereas it's on the surface that the true self is presented. And of course, these are cultural notions of the self. And the mass observers are writing in a cultural context where the assumption is that our authentic true self lies inside and can't be altered over time. So what the mass observers are doing when they're presenting enduring relationships and using this trope of authenticity, that sense of a real connection, that sense of being intimately connected to other people who know the real you, as it were, and you knowing the real them. This trope of authenticity, the mass observers are using it to indicate a self that's continuous and coherent. And in the West, that's important. In terms of being able to narrate a self, in terms of able to convey to other people a trustworthy self, we have to be able to do this, to narrate ourselves as coherent and consistent. And what better way to do that than to show that consistency through the consistency in our relationships? And that's where friendships are particularly important, as has also been noted by Spencer and Pearl, and also Smart and colleagues, is that by showing that our friendships have endured, we're actually telling something about ourselves as moral beings. So we are, if we have friendships that endure the test of time, so even if friendships might get rocky, we still stand by our friends, but importantly, they also are willing to stand by us. That means that we can demonstrate, we can show to other people that not only are we loyal, we are a loyal person who can be depended on, so consistency of character, but also we are the kind of person who friends want to stay loyal to. So it's a kind of a dual, it's two sides of the same coin. So in that sense, being able to talk about an enduring sense of belonging, particularly in relationships that are not expected to endure, that's one of the ways in which people can express, both experience and express, a continuous coherent self. So it's very important in terms of people's sense of self. But of course, we know that this enduring self is a paradox, because we're expected to express a self-sameness from one day to the next and from one year to the next. And that's important both in terms of, as I've explained, in terms of our sense of self, but also for social order and social cohesion. So if we think of trust, for example, that's based on the idea that I know I can predict what you will do today. On the basis of knowing you as my friend, I can predict what you're going to do today. But also in terms of social order and cohesion, the notion of people being accountable for their actions. So what mass observers are also doing is this is a way in which we can construct a moral self, by saying that there is a self-sameness, we are coherent and continuous, and that means that we can be held accountable. So my past self can be held accountable. So I can be held accountable for what my past self did, because I am that same person. But we know that this idea of self-sameness, there's a paradox there, because, you know, anyone who's lived any amount of time will also know that we change. And we can change quite considerably. And indeed, a lot of autobiographical narrating is about those breaks in our biographies, trying to sort of make sense of a break in our biography, such as illness or divorce, and trying to marry that with that sense of being able to, or basically being able to try to recreate that sense of coherence in our sense of self in our biography. And it's, in fact, the role or the function of autobiographical narrating is to try and marry this sense of continuity and also change. So that's why the fleeting relationships at work are actually very important, because they allow, in this case, they allow mass observers to contain in their narratives both the sense of continuity through their enduring relationships, but also then change. And that's where the distinction that they draw between fleeting relationships as superficial becomes very important again. Because if fleeting relationships are superficial, they don't really speak to the inner true, the kind of inner true authentic self. So the fact that these relationships have proved fleeting do not actually go against the moral presentation of self of these people. So they don't reflect negatively on the moral character of the self. So far, so linear. So what I've told you up till now are the kind of it's the duration of belonging is understood as linear. So understood in a kind of a linear chronology that can be measured in years, for example. So how many years of friendship has endured? And as I've explained, by talking about their enduring, particularly enduring friendships, we're able to construct a sense of a moral coherent self. But also I've talked about the importance then of the fleeting relationships in terms of being able to marry that paradox of self-sameness and change that we all experience. But there are then also other types of belonging where the duration isn't linear. It can't be sort of accounted for in this linear fashion. These are kind of, I call these a sense of belonging out of time. And these are sort of ethereal affinities, as Jennifer Mason has called them. So a sense of connection to the world that is difficult to explain, that we can't really put into a rational explanation. And there's two types. So these are sort of mysterious and inexplicable forms of belonging. And again, these are ones that really do puzzle the mass observers. So again, they spend quite a bit of time talking through what these senses of belonging might mean and how they might explain them, but never really being able to explain them. So they remain in some way mysterious. And again, these might be ones, experiences that are quite familiar to us. So, and they go against expected norms of how belonging is supposed to be built. So there's the assumption that belonging is sort of built up over time and is also built up through experience. So when it comes to friendships, there's the notion that belonging to friends, it does require some kind of regular contact. It does require that we keep up that intimacy, that we keep sharing our experiences and emotions and keep providing contact and support. But there are then friends who we might have a sense of belonging to, an immediate sense of belonging to, even if we've not seen each other for decades. So these are friendships that puzzle the mass observers. These are experiences of seeing, for example, school friends. So school friends you've not seen since school, and then seeing them again at a reunion in your 50s and having that immediate sense of connection again. And the mass observers are kind of, they're telling us that these are puzzling, these are mysterious, they can't really be explained. And the second form of kind of out of time sense of belonging is belonging to place. And particularly belonging to places where you've not lived. So again, the assumption is that particularly with places that, you know, you have a sense of belonging to the place where you were born and perhaps to places where you live and have lived for certain length of time. So the assumption is particularly with the belonging to place that that's something that's built up over time, but that again, it requires that everyday experience to be kept alive. And there's a type of belonging out of time that is experienced to places that one has not lived in. And I'm only going to talk about this second one here in the interests of time. So these are places where, as the mass observers say themselves, they have felt a sense of belonging for no reason. So again, that kind of alludes to the fact that belonging to place requires a reason. It requires either that we're born there or that we've lived there or that we know the place in some intimate way. So these are places that they have no connection to, but they've visited and had a sense of belonging to. And as the second mass observer there says, that she for some reason has always felt at home in areas where she has later found out her maternal side of the family comes from. And this is something she only found out. So she had this sense of belonging for some reason, again, kind of slightly inexplicable. And she only found out this, her sort of genealogical link to place, to those areas, once she started doing family history later on in life. And she then sort of says that, well, perhaps the sense of belonging to place can be partly genetic. Maybe it's something that can be passed down through the blood, as it were. And Anne-Marie Kramer, in her research on doing family research, has said that finding such a genealogical link to place can be one way of claiming belonging where you don't ordinarily fit. So again, underlying this is that notion that in order to claim belonging to place, you have to be able to A, show that you were born there, or B, that you've lived there. So those are places where we ordinarily fit. But a place we don't ordinarily fit into, where we don't have those experiences, is one where we have to find some kind of explanation. And finding that genetic link can be one way of doing it. Now, I say sort of that the genetic links are used here as a folk theory, as Brunusek calls them. So these are theories that are ways in which people can explain the world, but that aren't necessarily supported by scientific evidence. So hence the kind of tentative nature in which the mass observers there. So she's not the only one there who sort of implies that this sense of belonging to place can be passed down through the blood. But it's very tentatively proposed again, because the mass observers are probably aware that this isn't a rational explanation, that current science on genetics probably would not support this idea that that we can actually pass on a sense of belonging to place through our genes. So it's a folk theory. So it's a one way of trying to explain these very inexplicable experiences of belonging to place. And I'm saying that in describing these senses of belonging out of time, as it were, what the mass observers can then there do is depict a self that's timeless. So previously, we've seen how the self can be depicted as this coherent, continuous self that can be kind of put on a kind of chronological linear line. So a self that endures from 1970 through to 2016. But when it comes to these experiences of belonging to place and then thinking that maybe that's a genetic link to place, this is a timeless self. And it's a timeless self because it's a self that doesn't have a particular point of origin, temporal origin. So it doesn't have a date where that sense of belonging begins. And it's a self that goes beyond the lifetime of the individual, both into the past but also into the future. And it's a timeless self because it touches upon a notion of ourselves that is not only inherent, but it's kind of, because it's seen to be in our genes, it's something that is seen to exist always, but to exist beyond the lifetime of the individual. Because the idea of that kind of genetic link is that it does connect the generations. So something is passed from one generation to another in this kind of folk theory of how genetics works. So it's a sense of belonging or a self or part of oneself that is always there, even if it might at times be dormant. So in this case, it's kind of brought to life when that person visits a particular place, has that sense of connection with place, does a bit of family research and finds that, hey, actually all my family are from there, and that explains why I have a sense of belonging there. And Catherine Nelson has described a similar kind of self, so a continuing self in time, beyond birth and death, to past generations and other people's past and future. So also the idea that this is a self that can almost have an eternal life as well. So this is I've kind of said that this is a sense of belonging in time, an actual sense of belonging in time rather than through time. And it offers, as Kramer puts it, as kind of a certainty of the meaningfulness in the future, or even a sense of immortality. And Anne Game has written about archetypal or archaic experiences. And she has said that these archetypal or archaic experiences are to an extent magical because we can't fully explain them rationally. But they're also very potent experiences. And she argues that it's in these experiences that we actually forget ourselves as these bounded individuals. And she argues that we, at these moments, we feel most alive and most at home. So you'll be glad to know that I've come through to my last slide. So what does attending to the duration of belonging? Why is this important? I'm arguing that it's important because it means that we can look at how people construct their selves, but also it allows us a window into looking at how people experience time. And this is where I use the work of Henri Bergson in his work on time and duration. So Bergson distinguishes between time as something that we comprehend through symbolic systems such as language, and we measure through time through clocks and calendars and so on. So he distinguishes between time as measured with duration. And duration is to do with the immediate experience of time. And duration is about intensity rather than, so it's about quality rather than quantity. So when we experience duration, it's not necessarily in terms of how long it takes, but that's kind of what Bergson would call a kind of our experience of pure duration, which he actually says that the minute we start thinking about duration, we're turning it into something else. Because pure duration is the sense, is the experience of time we have before we fix it into words. So of course in these mass observation accounts, that experience has been fixed into words, but as we can see, in some cases, there's some difficulty in fixing that experience to words or rational explanations. Bergson also distinguishes between the superficial self and the passionate self. And he argues that the superficial self experiences time, and that is because the superficial self conforms to social conventions, such as conventions around narrative and conventions around how our selves should be continuous and coherent and linear. So it makes sense then that the superficial self experiences time, and if we remember, time is our way of understanding time as expressed through language, for example, or through measuring it by clocks. And Bergson says that the passionate self then is in touch with duration. And duration is then that experience that hasn't yet been rendered linear and logical by fixing it in language. So duration is actually puzzling and difficult to explain. And Anne Game has said that when we have these experiences of duration, profane time and duration sort of fall away. And it means that we can also then experience now and then as the same. So it's that sense of kind of folding time. And that might explain, for example, the experiences of meeting friends from decades back and having that immediate sense of connection. So a lot of mass observers at that point are saying that, oh, that's an experience where time falls away. So that's one of the phrases that the mass observers use quite a lot, of time falling away. So again, it's a kind of a timeless experience of belonging. So we've seen here that we can now add to Brunner's notion of the distributed self. So remember, we started with the distributed self as distributed across relationships. But that happens within a person's own biography. So within the relationships that person experiences. But we've also seen a distributed self that's distributed across past and future generations as well. And we've also seen how the self can be experienced and expressed as linear, coherent, and sort of temporally bounded within the biography of a person, but also as timeless and eternal.
Questions?
Vanessa? Thanks for that. That was brilliant. I just wondered if you've given any thought to how technology and social media might affect friendship and family ties as well. You were talking about the paradox, and I think that kind of continues on there. We have this dissolution of time and place.
Yeah.
And at the same time, we've kind of been given a sense of agency in exploring friendship and in a new medium that perhaps, you know, is relatively new.
Yeah, I mean, that is something I've been thinking about. I've not done empirical research on it, but I'm hoping to in the future. So my answer might not be fully coherent, but I think because there's a lot of talk about the time-space compression, where the notion is that because we can now instantaneously connect with people from across the world, that kind of compresses time and space. But I've actually been thinking that I think there's something more going on than that. It also layers time. People's experience of time can become layered in different ways. Exactly because you can be doing, you can be doing different things at the same time. So you can be texting people while you're on the bus, while you're commuting, and your kind of your different experiences, for example, the private and the public spheres, are kind of overlapping in new ways. They've always overlapped, but they're now overlapping in new ways. But that's so I've actually been thinking that we need to update the social interactionist theorizing to encompass what happens in the virtual world. But beyond that, that's as far as I've got now. I need to do some research on it as well. Yeah.
Thank you.
Nice.
I mean, going back to the very beginning, we talked about the friends versus the family and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And the picture you've built up is very much of a here's what most people were saying. I just wondered about outliers, people who were different from the others, and whether you found any of those, and whether they had different biographies, for example. I mean, I have a hunch that biography might lead to a different way of seeing these things.
Yeah.
I mean, there weren't in this data set, they were surprisingly sort of conforming to the kind of the cultural narrative of what friendship and what family is. So, like I said, there were only a few people who'd cut off ties with family and found that very disturbing. And the way that they talked about friendship was within that bound of friendship actually isn't expected to last. So therefore, if it does, it's surprising and needs explaining, and actually quite lengthy explanation. So the kind of the sections on friendship where the length is. So actually talking about the duration of family relationships, there wasn't much there because it's so taken for granted that it was only the kind of the more difficult family relationships or where there's ambiguity. So people who said, I belong with my family, but I don't belong because I'm so different from them. So those were ones where you had more time spent on talking about the duration of that sense of belonging because there was something troubling there. So it's usually the narratives, kind of autobiographical narratives, are usually ones that focus on some kind of dilemmas, some moral dilemma or otherwise a dilemma. So something that's puzzling and that people want to work out. So that's why you can use them as a way of kind of then reflecting what is the norm, because it's usually the norm, what's the norm doesn't get a lot of attention in this kind of autobiographical narrating.
I just wanted to take that point on, actually, because it's really interesting. I work in issues around national belonging, about national identity, and this connects over there and well. I'm just wondering about the way in which family structures are changing. You know, the 21st century family is far more complex in its framing.
Yeah.
And often that means that there is that sort of ambiguity between whether these are familial relationships or friendships.
Yeah.
I'm thinking about the sense of my own experience of my stepbrothers and things like that.
Yeah.
Did you find that came out at all there, that people commented on the actual way the family is structured?
Again, not in this date, and that's probably also because of the age structure. So
they're older,
so they wouldn't have, so there weren't that many people in their 20s, but the ones who were in their 20s had experienced what we would call the kind of the normative family of growing up with their biological parents. But it would be, that's definitely would be interesting.
I'm just wondering about distance. Distance is another thing that would be interesting. You think about the question about technology, by the way, that's changing.
Yeah.
You know, the 21st century family is often more and more transient and far more spread out than families were maybe 30, 40 years ago.
Yeah.
I wonder whether that will have a play in the way in those relationships change.
But definitely, I think if people are living in families where there's a combination of biological links and then, you know, step parenting and step siblings, then does that mean that you also start looking at the biological link differently? Because in these, there's the assumption that it's the biological link that matters and that matters most. And that's what the people were also talking about in those who had adult children. They were talking about their children as well in that sense, that of course your children always belong with you. But again, that's about the biological link. I mean, the interesting thing is that they didn't talk about the duration of their couple relationships that much. So that didn't receive, I mean, there were instances of divorce and there were people who'd been together with their partner for decades, but the actual duration of that wasn't discussed in any depth or detail. So it tended to be family and friendships that got most attention. Yeah.
Can I just ask a question, please? In relation to belonging, you talked about how people talked about belonging in relation to place and to family, relationships and so on. Did anybody talk about belonging in relation to belonging to communities or, you know, in relation to faith and things like that?
Yeah, religion, church. Church came up a lot, yes. And community as well, so local communities, but also those, who, for example, who volunteered, so or had particular hobbies or interests. So those were quite important. But again, don't come up here because they weren't discussed in relation to time. Mm-hmm. So those weren't sort of temporal forms of belonging or weren't discussed as temporal forms of belonging. Yeah.
Hi, Georgia. You said at the very beginning, and by its very nature, that participants are primarily white, middle class, heterosexual. And so obviously you probably haven't got responses from people who might, for example, identify as LGBT. And I wondered how or what difference responses from them might say about sense of belonging and so on.
I think very different. Well, what I've said in another paper is that this mass observation data is very interesting because it actually allows a window into how what we would consider the dominant majority, how they experience belonging, which is something that hasn't actually been researched that much, or how they experience non-belonging also hasn't been researched that much. But I'm sure because the few people who are in the... Because in the whole 180, there's a few people who are ethnic minority and a few more LGBT people. So they do discuss belonging, and that's an important part of their sense of belonging or national belonging. So there's a few people who have sort of different, have a combinations of different nationalities, for example, in their parents. So one parent might be Swiss and the other British and so on. So it does come up as an important thing for a sense of belonging.
Can we go back to your very first slide? Is that possible?
Yeah.
Thanks very much. That sense of ease with self and surrounding world as a starting point, it's very Giddens-esque in its understanding. And one of the other things that Giddens and Kinsval have looked at is not the concept of belonging, but it's the concept of security. Mm-hmm. Coming out of that as a starting point, and in particular ontological security. I'm just wondering, is there an overarching concept that you come across to do with people seeking security rather than belonging?
What do you mean overarching? So a concept that's not belonging and not ontological security?
That's more than that. It's a search for security, and the belonging is only just one expression of that.
Yes, it is, and I don't approach this from a Giddensian point of view. Yeah, I approach it from a phenomenological point of view, and in phenomenology we would say that it's the habitual and the familiar. So a sense of belonging, we tend to have a sense of belonging to the habitual and the familiar, and that gives us that sense of security of knowing what to do where, of knowing sort of how we fit, but also knowing how to act in particular situations. So belonging affords that sense of security, having that sense of, and then of course, and that's probably why so much of the research actually looks at not belonging, A, because it's easier to research because people have an easier time talking about it, but also because that's where the sense of security is lost.
And did anything go on to express their sense of belonging in those terms?
Security. Well, because a lot of them, because one of the first questions on the directive was, what does belonging mean to you? So a lot of the people do actually, because love them, a lot of them do follow the directive and do actually then write about the things that we ask them to. Although I was explaining to Tracy earlier that some then, that's the beauty of mass observation, that people can interpret the directive as they wish. So some write something that's important to them and others follow the directive more closely. But a lot of them did then start the account by explaining what belonging means to them and the concepts of home, feeling safe, people knowing you and you knowing people. Those were the most common things that came up in terms of explaining what belonging is. Yeah.
just a quick question. I'm curious, because you said most of them were female. Is there any difference between men and
women? No. I was surprised. I was really surprised, because that's one of the things I looked at. Given that men and women are supposed to write differently, especially time, so women are meant to have a more cyclical understanding of time and men have a more linear, but I didn't find these differences. But again, it's a fairly small sample, but also because each respondent is free to write as they wish, it means that you can't do comparisons like that don't necessarily work fully, but I didn't see any sort of gendered differences there. It's interesting though, because I'm writing a paper on nostalgia at the moment, and there the majority of the respondents were men. So men, in the mass observation data at least, men seem to be more likely to write about nostalgia than women.
Can I just ask, when you're talking about enduring relationships with family and friends, I know you touched on sort of ancestral and ancestors in that sense of theory and planning, but did they ever talk about sort of deceased and bereavement, but directly sort of like to siblings and children within their sense of belonging, their sense of family?
I don't think I quite understood. So siblings and deceased?
So you know, I'm talking about sort of feeling like belonging within their family, yeah, and with their friendships. I just wondered whether they ever sort of integrated those, any sort of ongoing relationships with sort of family members, but not ancestors, as in much more sort of closer family.
So when I talked about enduring family relationships, those are with family of origin, so that's parents and siblings mostly,
yeah,
and grandparents.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah. So did they still talk about, was it only living relatives, or did they ever integrate notions of
it? There were some who talked about, so again, just a handful who talked about having a continued sense of belonging to, for example, a deceased grandparent. So there was one woman who placed her grandfather in her relational diagram for today, for now, even though he was dead, you know, years, he'd been dead for years. But she said she still places him in her relational diagram for now because she still feels that sense of connection to him. And also there were some who said that even though they've never met their ancestors, because they've done family research, they have that sense of belonging. It's as though they know them. So you can have that sense of belonging. So A, with a dead person, but also possibly with deceased ancestors you've never even met. Yeah. You're coming back for more.
I just wonder if there's room for an exploration of belonging and friendship in specific areas of employment. You briefly touched on employment.
Yeah.
But if you think about something like academia, you've got a convergence of general interest and work that overlap.
Yeah.
So I wonder if maybe there's room there.
Anne Cronin has written about that. She's recently published I can send you the reference if you email me, because I was just reading it on the train as I was coming up. And that's about work, friendships at work, and the way that the people she interviewed talked about friendships at work was different from here. So they were talking about very intimate connections at work, and exactly because you might experience things at work that you wouldn't normally with other people. So there was one who was talking about, for example, restraining patients, that you wouldn't do physically. Restraining people is something you only do with your colleagues, and that creates some kind of bond and relationship that you wouldn't have, that can then be very strong. So yeah, check up, and she's published quite a lot on friendship recently, so yeah.
Okay, we'd like to say thank you very much to Vanessa again.